next event is on April 10th at 5:30, and it'll deal with the issue of zoning and its intended and unintended consequences. And that'll take place in the Amato Room over at Irvine Auditorium. Great. So today's topic is policies around vacant properties. Our panel will discuss the current state of the problem in Philadelphia and recent efforts to address it. We're also fortunate to have Baltimore's Housing Commissioner, Michael Braverman, with us to discuss how our neighbor to the south is working on similar issues. In 1950, Baltimore City had 950,000 residents, and Philadelphia had, of course, over 2 million. In the most recent American Community Survey, the comparable figures were 621,000 for Baltimore and 1.5 million for Philadelphia. Although population decline can be seen as the source of the problem, those declines don't in themselves explain why the two cities today include nearly 100,000 vacant or abandoned housing units. Let me introduce our panel. Ira Goldstein, President of Policy Solutions at Reinvestment Fund, will discuss the scope of the problem, some of the spillover effects that vacant properties have on their neighborhoods, and some possible strategies for using the newly created Philadelphia Land Bank to address the issue more effectively. Next, Jennifer Cates, currently Chief of Staff for Councilmember Helen Gim, and who was involved in the creation of the Land Bank, will discuss the process through which the Land Bank came into being and what goals it was intended to achieve. Next, Michael Braverman, who has served as a prosecutor, director of code enforcement's legal team, as deputy commissioner of permits and code enforcement, and now as housing commissioner for the city of Baltimore, will explain how that city uses a data-driven approach to address some of the same problems we face today in Philadelphia. Finally, Nora Liktosh, who will join us soon, executive director of the Women's Community Revitalization Project, will give us a community-level perspective of the issues, including a critical view of the land bank and how other strategies can be used as a means of mobilizing community residents to hold public officials and private interests accountable. Okay, I think I'll turn it over to Ira.
Great. Thanks, Mark. Excuse me, Nora.
Under view. Yeah. This is why I'm standing close.
Yeah. It'll be up there. Right, here's Nora.
Should we do the quiz first?
Oh, maybe we can.
Oh.
Sorry.
Nora likes to be dramatic. Do you want to do the quiz?
Oh, we're doing it first?
Yeah, we're going to do it first.
Perfect.
Here, I'll do this.
Turn to the person next to you and try to answer them. I'm going to scream rather than use this, thank you. I'm going to sit next to you so you have a partner. Do it in twos. We just have a few minutes to do it, and I'm late, and I'm really sorry. So answer as many questions as you can. It's about the Philadelphia Land Bank. And there's some tricky questions. And I have chocolate for prizes if you get the right answer.
I usually give out a nickel tomorrow.
I'm district mandated to put their vacant land in the land bank, true or false?
False.
False, do you believe that's false?
I got you.
I say true.
Okay, the falses get candy. Is there public access to information about each sale and transfer of land? What do you think?
False.
False.
Yes.
True.
It's mandated in the legislation that there is. Take candy if you put
true.
More candy on this side. Okay. Is there a clear process which is followed by the land bank for identifying vacant land for acquisition and disposition? True or false?
False.
There is not. The ordinance which created the land bank has language in it that says that the land bank should seek to promote development that ensures permanent or long-term affordability and socioeconomic diversity within all neighborhoods. Is that it? We made it.
Good.
True. That is true. It's in the language.
Which one's true?
That's true.
Which one? Number 4?
Number 4.
Number 4 is true. Yeah. Take a piece of candy if you have true. The land bank was created to be both a powerful tool for equitable development and to bring in new resources through the creation of market rates. Think that's true?
I think it's true.
There's clarity on the part of those in leadership in the city, in the city government, that land banks should be a useful tool for our city.
I didn't close.
That is close. You know that one. You know the answer.
Any answer with clarity in it.
So there's some really good government people here, and we appreciate that. The 2017 land bank strategic plan states there's 40,000 vacant parcels in the city. True or false? The land bank has developed and received public comment and adopted a strategic plan. We're in March. Do you think we have one for 2018?
No, it's not
false. I know that's really bad. Okay, this next question has two parts. Since 2013, when the land bank ordinance was passed, the land bank has disposed of, was it A, B, or C? 94, 315, or 484 parcels? What do you think? Tell me how many homes are affordable to Philadelphians who earn 100% of our county median income, which is 40,000 for a family of four. Is it 1, 9, or 81 on those 94 parcels?
9.
9. That's very smart. A member of the land bank gets to throw out the first pitch of the Phillies game. If you're on the board, it's a good opportunity to get on the board. There will be a public annual progress report on the land bank goals. True or false?
True.
It's in the legislation.
There
we want it, and we want it not to be a PR document, but to be the truth. Okay, now I'm done. I'm so sorry.
As you probably noticed, Nora has arrived. And I should tell you that Ira almost got 100% on this. Just missed one.
And, the progress report.
The progress report, because there isn't one now, so he thought that it wasn't.
That it wouldn't exist.
But that's an excellent. He did so well, though, that I think we're going to allow him to go first.
I think some candy needs to come up towards Ira.
What's second prize?
2 weeks.
Right. So now, as smart as we are off this quiz, just how much vacant land and how many vacant buildings are there? So about 4 or 5 months ago, a reporter at the American Banker reached out to me and said that he was doing a podcast on vacant land and vacancy. He said vacancy in the United States, and he wanted to know how much there was. And our people at our office said, Ira will talk. So, and then I get into a cold sweat because I couldn't figure out how much there was. And I think that before we go too deeply into this, what I can tell you with certainty, across the country, nobody knows. Maybe a few cities people know. And I would argue that in most cities, people don't know with precision. But across the country, nobody really knows. So this is just a sampling of them. These are places I've been to where we've done our work. I can't tell you which one is which. I can tell you the one down there, that's the very bottom, that green area right there, that's the site, the former Pruitt-Igoe site, which was a public housing tower, one of the largest public housing, failed public housing complexes that was demolished or in pieces, but starting around 1972. To this day, it sits as a green space, and they're trying to figure out what to do with it. Some small piece of it has been carved off for another activity. The two pictures on the bottom, by the way, and that's a former train station in Detroit. Gonna do really cool videos, but other than that, it's not functioning as a train station. It's literally just wide open and you can see through it at the right angle. But these pictures, and they're really indistinguishable, but I can tell you that they come from places from Philadelphia to Baltimore to Pittsburgh to McKeesport to Selma, Alabama. And I think those are all the places that are represented there. But quite frankly, they look almost indistinguishable to me, which in some large measure is a reflection of the fact that cities around the country, be they like northeastern cities, mid-Atlantic cities, southern cities, you know, cities with long histories, cities with, you know, shorter histories, they all have the same kinds of problem that they're grappling with to, you know, frankly, to a greater or lesser degree, but it looks more or less the same. I think actually one of those is New Orleans as well. I believe it's the one right over there. This is Detroit. And, you know, Detroit is a place, as you know, Mark started out by giving some population numbers about Baltimore. Detroit is a city that at its population peak had like 2.1 million people. Today, they don't know how many people are exactly there. It's probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 650,000. So when you go from 2.1 million to 650,000, you're gonna have vacancy. And you're gonna have a lot of vacancy, even if household, you know, composition changes and things like that. You're just gonna have a ton of vacancy. That represents just a couple years worth of demolitions, each one of those dots. Some of those dots are actually colored differently. And frankly, some of those dots, you know, look like one, but they're actually more like 8 or 10 demolitions, you know, geographically in a small area, and you can't distinguish them by map at that scale. So just since 2014, they've torn down 13,606 properties. If you were to sort of add together what has been lost out of the city of Detroit as a result of the vacancy and demolition and the like that has occurred, if you exclude cemeteries and you exclude parks from the total landmass of the city of Detroit, conservative estimates are that 20% or more of the city of Detroit is vacant. And there are places where that 20% would feel, quite frankly, fully occupied, because there are communities in Detroit where you drive around and they're just empty street after empty street after empty street. You just can't imagine what that kind of vacancy looks like in a city that at one time had, you know, such a vibrant economic base and population base. But to get to some of the bigger numbers, you know, the sort of the large picture numbers, what we're looking at here is a chart that reflects from calendar year 2000 on up through 2016. In those bluish bars, you're looking at the total number of housing units in the United States. And we grew from about 116 million to what's now about 135,500,000, something of that, you know, rough estimate. That dotted line there, we're going from about 9% in 2000 to about 12.5% currently, is the percentage of the housing stock that is vacant. Now, that number is not necessarily the pictures that I showed you in that slide with Detroit and Selma and all those other places. This is some combination of that plus, you know, an apartment building that is, you know, 80% occupied, a set of homes that are up for sale or a set of apartments that are up for rent, et cetera. But still in all, we had reached a peak, a post-recession peak of about 13%, and we've moderated down to about 12.5%. So what that says is today, across the United States, about 1 in 8 housing units is not occupied. Okay. Now, you can sort of pull apart vacancy a little bit. There's from the census data, they give you like total vacant, and then they have categories like a property is vacant for sale. So in other words, somebody's looking to sell their home, they've already moved out, and they're waiting for somebody to come and buy it and occupy it. It could be vacant for rent, same logic. It could be vacant because it's seasonal or recreational, so shore houses, mountain houses, and things of those nature. On April 1st, when they go and do the census, nobody's there, it's listed as vacant. They have vacant for migrant workers, and you know, in our region here in Chester County, in the far reaches of Chester County, there's a lot of migrant farm worker housing and the like. So you have those
named categories of vacant. Then they have something that they call other vacant. So that's vacant housing units that are neither for sale, nor rent, nor held for recreational use, nor for migrant workers. These vacant units, you know, in our experience looking from city to city, they oftentimes are the ones that kind of look like those pictures that I showed you. Those are the houses that are sitting there and there is no particular use for them. What you'll see is, on this chart, the blue lines represent the total vacant stock, and that sort of is, you know, the bar representation of the line on the previous chart, and total vacant stock ranging from about 10 or 11 million up to we're at a little bit above 16 million vacant housing units from now, right? Then you have these other vacants, and those are the ones that I was talking about. So in 2000, we were at under 2 million, and today we are at almost 6 million. So that 6 million now represents almost 33% of the vacant housing stock. So if you think about all that housing stock in the United States that doesn't currently have an occupant, one third of it doesn't have an occupant, and frankly, without prospects for an occupant in the foreseeable future, because it's not for sale, it's not for rent, it's not a shore house, it's not a mountain house, it's not a migrant farm worker house, or anything else of that nature. These one third of the vacant housing stock, I would venture to say, are the kinds of things that end up being, you know, what Nora works with and the communities that she works with, Michael works with in Baltimore, and what Jennifer is thinking about as that stock ultimately that may come into the land bank of the city of Philadelphia. In terms of some of the cities, what we call sometimes legacy cities, Detroit, East St. Louis, Cleveland, Camden, St. Louis, Baltimore, Pittsburgh, Philly, Indianapolis, Milwaukee, Columbus, and the United States all the way on the end. These bars are representing the number of other vacants in each of those places. So Philadelphia is now sitting at about 80,000 other vacant housing units, which is a huge number. I mean, that is a huge number of housing units for which, again, there is no foreseeable occupant. That represents, amongst all those cities that I just named, roughly 22% of the vacant house, of the total vacant housing units that we have. That's Detroit. I'm sorry. Detroit is 80,000. Philadelphia is it's about 45,000. My apologies. And so from city to city, Detroit's the highest. They're at about 22% of their vacant housing stock. That compares to a national average of about 4%. And then if you look at places like Milwaukee or Indianapolis or Philly, we're at about 7%. Now, 7%, you know, I also have the privilege of teaching the Urban Studies 200 class, which is sort of a stat methods class. And we oftentimes spend time thinking about, like, what does a number mean? 7%, what does that mean? You know, because it sounds like a small number. Well, that means 1 in 14. So if you were to go to, like, a typical row house block in the city of Philadelphia, a couple of them are going to be vacant, because on any row house block, you're going to have 20, 30 housing units, depending upon how small they are. So that 7% is actually like a fairly large number when you think about it. When you think about the visual representation and what it means to everybody else who lives on that block, right? Map of the city of Philadelphia. That one on the upper left is Philadelphia in 1977. This map on the lower right is 2001. These are maps that we created back in 2001 when the city had its Neighborhood Transformation Initiative plan. At that time, there was an estimate that there were, roughly speaking, 30 or so thousand vacant housing units and vacant commercial properties in the city of Philadelphia. Nobody exactly knew what the number was. You know what the number is today? Darn near the same thing. It's almost the same thing. And we probably demolish somewhere in the neighborhood of, I don't know, 800 to 1,000 units a year. Something of that nature is my guess. Something of that. So we are still, notwithstanding the fact that our population has sort of, you know, we've stopped losing people. We've actually begun to grow the population base of the city of Philadelphia. We have what, you know, what the former CEO of our organization said is essentially like, We're still in some ways like a blight machine in the city of Philadelphia. We are still creating these blighted properties in not trivial way. So again, you know, we actually did some projections out to what 2020 would look like based on the models of, you know, looking at 77 in 2001. And I gotta tell you, in 2018, and looking at the 2020 projections, they don't actually look all that bad. What you see actually is a little bit of a diaspora of the vacant properties throughout the parts of the city that at this time didn't seem to have many. So now let's sort of, I don't know if you're gonna be able to see these, but I'm gonna just go through a quick series of maps to show you a little bit about the context of where today some of the land bank properties are sitting in relation to other characteristics of the city. So again, my apologies, the contrast is not great here in the colors that I used, but there are little orange dots on that map. And those little orange dots, if I could, I'm gonna point you out where most of the clusterings are and get your eyes sort of trained on them. So in here, there's an awful lot of them. Here, there's a bunch. Pushing your way up, you're seeing orange dots. And then this is actually not too far from where we are right now. This is a little bit south and west of where we are. And then this is south of Center City. Each of those places are places where you have clusterings of dots. Does anybody notice about anything about where those dots are in relation to the shading on the map? Do you see a pattern there?
North Philadelphia.
North Philadelphia. And what about the characteristics of the places where you see those, aside from the neighborhood? And you're exactly right. North Philly, West Philly. What's being mapped in the shade is the percentage of the properties that are the equivalent of that other vacant. So what you see is the land bank at this point has a ton of properties in areas that are otherwise full of other properties that are probably sitting in that very same condition. There are some exceptions to that, and there are some exceptions in terms of, you know, what what the market conditions are in some of those communities. But still in all, what you see is the major concentrations tend to be in places where there already are substantial levels of vacancy. This sort of drills in, it's the same map, but it drills into the West Philly area. So the area in the lower part of the map, you're now looking about, you know, sort of north of Drexel, let's say. And then Brewery Town and the Art Museum area, right where Mark is pointing. And then really up a little bit to, you know, towards the edge of the slide, you're able to see, you know, the Temple campus and actually this big clustering in here is probably that which is part of the Choice neighborhood in the city of Philadelphia. So again, what you're seeing is the vast majority of these dots really are sitting in areas, again, where there are plenty other vacant properties that are sitting out there. Begs the question then, you have to start to think like, okay, so if I control these dots, what do I want to do with one in one of those dark red areas or even one of the lighter red areas as opposed to one of the areas where there isn't a difference? So would the conditions of that place, should the conditions of that place have any influence on the way you think about what you do with that dot if you are the custodian of those pieces of property like the land bank will be? This is a representation of the entirety of the city of Philadelphia, and what we've done here is try and grade out the real estate market in terms of a variety of factors that reflect the vitality of the market. The areas that are shaded in purple and blue are very strong real estate markets. The areas that are shaded in those mustard colors, those are kind of middle market areas. And the areas that are shaded in the salmon colors, those are the markets that are really the most challenged, the most stressed markets. High levels of vacancy, very little investment activity as evidenced by building permits, et cetera. And what you'll see is, again, in the main, these land bank properties are clustered in the areas that are themselves relatively stressed real estate markets. Now, the key, I think, in thinking about what the land bank will do with some of these is not only think about, like, what's here, what's in this spot where this property is, but what's around it and what's happening and what's the nature of growth and expansion of some of these areas? Because if I'm holding on to properties in a place like this, which is just above the huge growth machine that is Penn and Drexel, I might think about that a whole lot differently than if I'm sitting on a vacant property right here
which really doesn't have the same kind of economic wherewithal pushing the market within which that property is sitting. But again, the overwhelming majority, so if you actually did the count of it, you'd find that 18 land bank properties are in strong markets in the city of Philadelphia. You'd find 168 in the middle market, but almost 900 are in the most stressed markets in the city of Philadelphia. Again, these kinds of market conditions, and you'll hear, you know, both from Nora, who works in a couple different kinds of markets, and from Jennifer and from Michael in Baltimore, how they think about the influence of the market in terms of a strategy for either acquiring or disposing or what you do with those properties. Now what I'm going to do is just show you a couple quick slides and be done. This is a set of maps that looks at, how best to describe it, the way an area is changing economically. And the nature of that change is such that its prices are rising at a much faster rate than the income levels of the people who live there at some earlier point in time. So in other words, what we're trying to get at is a scenario like this. My grandfather lived here, my father lived here, I lived here, my kid could never live here, right? That's kind of the scenario. This map is going to be shaded in such a way that when you see it transition from brown to tan to white to light blue to dark blue, what you're seeing is a mapped reflection of that phenomena. So they lived here, but I can't live here anymore. And why do I show you that? Because you're going to see a transition in this map where some of the places where the land bank actually owns properties are areas that are going to be transitioning up through that ramp. The part of Philadelphia that you're looking at right here is over here, right above Mark's Head, is Pennsport and Queen Village. This is Washington Avenue, I think, right? This heavy line right here. So if you look sort of to the west side of Broad Street, what you're really looking at is that neighborhood that's known as Point Breeze. Okay? So watch how Point Breeze changes. I'm going to show you five maps. As the areas transition again from brown to tan to white to light blue to dark blue. So what you saw was, look how much of Point Breeze went from tan and brown to blue, right? And what that suggests is that's a neighborhood where it is changing so rapidly that the people who were in there several years ago would have a hard time replacing themselves, let's say, right? Replacing themselves with people who are economically like themselves. But interestingly, you do have a bunch of dots within here. So the land bank owns properties in there. And again, strategically, do you think differently about what you would want to do with a property that's sitting in a place like that, that goes from tan to blue, than you would in an area that is, you know, one of the other markets in the city? And what I would argue, and I think you'll hear a couple different expressions of it, is this kind of market change is one that really should influence what you want to do. And if one of, and as Nora pointed out, there is a strategic plan for the land bank, and if one of the tenets of that strategic plan is one that sort of focuses on equitable development, the ability to think about having control of properties, not a ton of them, but having control of properties in an area that's going through that kind of transition affords the city sort of a wonderful opportunity to say, maybe I could step in and hang on to some affordability for people so that as this neighborhood transitions, the lower income people who were there can continue to benefit from, you know, the changes, the positive changes that occur in the neighborhood. So with that, I'm going to stop and turn it to Jennifer.
We'll appropriate the septa, we're getting there, so again. This was the vision. Councilman Camino Sanchez is the lead sponsor of the land bank legislation. It was a many, many year process to even get a bill passed. I think that, let's see, 2011, I think we started, introduced the first bill in May of, something like May of 2011, and as you'll see, it finally passed in December of 2013, so that was just the legislative timeline. So that was the vision of what it could do. One of our primary goals was fixing what I would call the delinquency deadlock. We have, as Ira mentioned, many thousands of properties abandoned, dragged down with aged debt and tangled title that keep it, even though the markets are weak, these are structural forces that are keeping the properties from getting into the hands of someone who can at least pay a minimal tax bill and try to care for the land. There's an interesting map that Philadelphia VIP has created that maps compares the name of the last record title holder of properties in Philadelphia with the Social Security Debt Index, and so you can see where the properties are owned by someone who is deceased, like the record, the name, it's in the name of someone who is deceased. So then our tax lien and foreclosure system, so that's our property taxes, our water debt, our demolition liens, including the liens from the NTI demolitions in the early 2000s, the system we have to foreclose on those liens and sell them through a sheriff sale process is not structured or incentivized to support our redevelopment goals. And what that means is that at a sheriff sale, the highest bidder gets a property, the market is very weak, someone can continue to sit on the land. As you'll see in the next slide, land will often just recycle through that system. Someone will take it, they'll sit on it, it'll get tax linked, and it'll go back in. And since NTI, without new condemnation funding and with stricter condemnation rules, after the Kelo Supreme Court case, we do not have another tool locally to do targeted acquisitions or assemblies. If you're trying to assemble multiple parcels of land for a redevelopment project, we needed a tool to be able to do that. So this is an image from the land bank's first plan that shows sort of with our current, with the pre-land bank system, how properties would sort of cycle through that delinquency cycle versus what the land bank ideally would do in being able to acquire properties for specific uses and dispose of them to targeted screened buyers or takers, hopefully to be able to advance them into those more productive reuses. And our other primary goal was ending what we call the alphabet soup of public agencies. This is a goal of which you'll see later. We've had only partial success. Arguably, you could say we've added an additional acronym to the alphabet soup, PLB, which is the Philadelphia Land Bank. So land had been spread between these multiple agencies, the public property, City of Philadelphia, the Redevelopment Authority, PRA, PHDC, the Philadelphia Housing and Development Corporation, PHA and PAID, the Industrial Development Entity, and I'll come back to this no central inventory, but what that has meant is that property that was being disposed of, especially if you're trying to assemble it, there's all these different processes for applying for the land, a lot of different decision makers, and it was incredibly inefficient, so the vision of the land bank was consolidating all that fragmented inventory into one place. The city did take a pre-land bank incremental step of putting in place uniform disposition policies in 2012 and an online front door where you could see the properties in one place, including with a map. But at that point, there was still no uniform process or timeline, so we were trying to fix that with the land bank. And I would note that this no central inventory thing was a really big deal. I forget if you were at one of those early meetings, but there was like a I came into the city in 2010, and they'd been working at that point for some time to try to just get a list in one place of what are the addresses that public entities own. Like, what's the total list of addresses? And that was like a many, many, many year, many person process. And so I know the bar is low, but like, I'm gonna talk a lot about how where we still have to go, but it was a long, hard path even to get to a point where we have a uniform master list that you can see on a website and you can check it out and all that stuff. And so one of the other problems we were seeking to solve was that land use and disposition policies varied by mayoral administration. So they would change, they weren't stable, they could, a new mayor would come in with totally new priorities and approaches, kind of throw things out. The policies did not meet on-the-ground needs for land use. So what that meant when I came in is that properties were being disposed of solely using appraisals. Appraisals systematically mispriced properties in weak markets because they had to look at comparative sales, and there were not real market sales in a lot of parts of the city. So you would have someone apply. They wouldn't have a price up front. They would be interested. They would go all the way through the process. Then they would finally get an appraised price. The price would be crazy. You couldn't contest it. Person would walk away. It would sit for another year. Someone else would come, and the same thing would happen. And unlike in the private real estate market, when a property's sitting and the price sort of floats down because people aren't buying it, that was not happening at the city. And so that was a systemic problem. Another systemic problem was that there was the sort of prioritization focused on housing as the sole highest and best use for land. We didn't really have policies in place that let us look at markets realistically and say, there's parts of the city where we don't foresee market rate housing and there's no nonprofit affordable housing capacity there. And so we need to have policies that sort of look at open space as a longer term use, like gardening and other kind of land use strategies for large scale vacancy, like what I would describe in Detroit. And so our policies didn't really fit that. So there was no way for people who were trying to do garden projects to get the kind of leases that they would need to invest and care for land. So, and the policies had no formal status. It was just a piece of paper that might be in someone's drawer. They're not formal regulations. They're not codified. There's no process to update them. There's no public hearing to give comment on what they are. So those were some of the problems we were trying to fix. So we sought to pass this land bank law. Councilman Camino Sanchez introduced it, finally passed it. We had a broad coalition that Nora will talk more about that included gardeners, nonprofits, churches, commercial builders, and unions. And there was a lot of consensus about the need to do something. Now, that was not really a new consensus. People have been working on this idea of a central land bank type entity for a number of years. At one point, someone like anonymously mailed me a proposal for a Philadelphia land bank from like the 90s or the early 2000s or something like that, which is a little depressing. But so yes, there was a broad consensus on the need. There was a lot of debate over what the fix should look like, particularly the appropriate role for politicians and the city council, the legislature, in the disposition process. One of the challenges that we had is that the city charter, to keep it simple, effectively required council to pass some sort of approval of individual property dispositions. And because of the practice that people know as councilmatic prerogative, where district council members get an effective veto over dispositions in their districts, that was the status quo, that was the charter. If we wanted to change it, council had to agree to change it. There was some fierce advocacy, a lot of different approaches sort of floated. But at the end of the day, a lot of elements of the existing system in terms of that kind of approval process were kept in place. In some ways, I think the process may have even gotten I think some things were streamlined in that now we don't have to go through the city law department as a stop and the public property commissioner as a stop and council as a stop, but we've preserved a number of these choke points, as we'll talk about, that have really tied our hands in terms of streamlining the disposition as we have. So how we want the land bank to work. The vision is that it's a powerful acquisition tool. One of the benefits of the key sort of this key sort of power the land bank has, we were implementing a state law authorizing land banks in localities throughout the Commonwealth. The key tool here is that the state empowered local land banks to use tax foreclosure as an acquisition tool. What that means is if a property is tax delinquent and there's a successful foreclosure, you file a court case to foreclose on a property, the owner doesn't pay it off, you win that judgment. When you go to a sheriff sale, the land bank has the power to be the winning bidder at that sheriff sale, even if there are other bidders. It kind of just can take that property through the sheriff sale. And what that means is that currently, without a land bank, if a property owes $10,000 of taxes and someone buys it at sheriff sale for $100,000, the $10,000 goes to the city to pay off the taxes, and then the owner gets the $90,000. That either can sit in an account for the owner or it goes to the owner if they're around. If the land bank takes the property and then sells it for $100,000, or maybe even sells it for $200,000 because it has more time to actually market the property, the taxes get paid off and the land bank will keep all of that extra value. And it can use that value to recycle to fund future acquisitions. So it's a really powerful tool. It helps compensate localities who have to deal with the blight costs of all of this vacancy. And so that's one of the reasons that we would want to use it. And our goal, it has all these other powers that you can see there. So the other vision here was that we would have transparency and accountability. We tried to build aspects into the legislation to ensure that. One of the key pieces was to have published policies that were developed through a formal process with public comment. I think that has been one of the relative successes. There's been some friction and some growth from the transition of mayoral administrations, which I think is inevitable, but we had a base that we are working off of, and that was like a clear, like the policy was what was being amended. You're changing a clear existing document, you're not throwing it out, you're kind of modifying it, and there are hearings, an opportunity for people to give comments. And so I think that that did insulate us from some of the challenges that happen in the street and other transition regarding land use policy. We do have an online inventory of the properties that are held within the public agencies. It's in one place. You can get it at philadelphialandbank.org. And you can see some pieces of information about status of those properties. We do have front-end pricing now compared to 2010, 2011, which means it's down right now to refresh it, but like you can see prices for most of the properties except the ones that are particularly valuable that still get individualized appraisals, but that expands the market for a property because it's easier to know that you might want something if you know the ballpark of what it's gonna cost you. And it's easier to get notice of the status of properties if you're trying to keep an eye on one in your neighborhood. The land bank was mandated to set deadlines to process the applications and to track them throughout the process. That has not been successful yet. I think that there have been both administrative and political problems with staff putting information into a system. The system, you know, you can't track something if you don't have access to the data. And so we just have not had any success yet in having any sort of like accountability tool for how our property is processing through, you know, what from application to approval to actual deed settlement. And we're supposed to have detailed annual performance reporting, which is delayed but has existed. And I think it's something that we want to continue to refine. And that performance reporting, as Nora I think is going to get into a little bit more, looks at what types of uses that we transfer property for and who gets it and tries to put that in one place. And so another thing that was a feature of the land bank legislation was having a strategic approach and using data, some of the kind of data that Ira described, to help shape our decision making. Our first strategic plan was done by Interface Studios. We updated it at some point after Mayor Kenney came in. We are delayed to do the next update, and we hope to contract an outside firm again to do a sort of like a bigger refresh. And so I think that has been one of the other things that has been a little bit, there's been some transition between administrations. Initially, it included all of these data sets and incorporated our city's comprehensive plan and individual community plans. It identified opportunity sites. So as you'll see in the following maps, it would try to compare information about the need for certain uses, like does this neighborhood need more affordability or does it need more market rate housing, and do we have vacant land in that neighborhood that could be used to fulfill those purposes. And our hope was that that data could be used in the sort of administrative and political decision-making process to help guide a question like, should we use an urban garden here or an apartment building? We thought that if you can see that there are no other urban gardens within a very large radius, maybe that helps shape the conversation a little bit differently than if you don't have that kind of information. So that first strategic plan was one of the first time we had access to vacancy data and tax delinquency data and could look at the public inventory in context with all of the other private abandoned tax delinquent properties. And this is an example of the kind of analysis that plan had that looked at where you need affordability, and the black was where there was potential vacant inventory to acquire. And so taking stock of where we are about a little more than 4 years after the legislation passed, and this is an image also from that first strategic plan that used all of that data to try to analyze what are potential uses for the existing public inventory. So for example, we analyzed where do we have a publicly owned vacant lot that is next to what appears to be an owner-occupied home, such that that might be a good candidate for our side yard program. And so the vision was we could use that data, we could analyze that data, and we could use it to try to market or target uses for properties and help people, you know, make good decisions about what a property might be, what might be a suitable use for a different property. So So in terms of our progress in transferring properties in, properties need to move into the land bank according to whatever the legal process is that govern those properties before the land bank. So if city charter says that a public property has to go through council to move into the land bank, we can't just shove it all in. This goes to Nora's question on the quiz. Council members have to approve each individual property for transfer. So at this point, as you see at the bottom, we've moved a little more than 2,000 in. We have about 3,000 that we think could move over from other agencies from that alphabet soup, but haven't yet been moved through council and approved to go in. And then we have, you know, close to 2,000 that are kind of in the system but are not identified as available. Maybe they're in process to transfer to someone, maybe they're rented out for, you know, to another user. And so there's still some data questions, though we've done a lot to clean up the inventory. There's still some data questions about those properties. We spent a lot of time, though, a significant amount of time in the 4 or so years since the land bank passed, doing research to clean up properties, to evaluate the deeds, to look at debt, so that when people apply, the properties are kind of like transfer ready, which had been a historic problem. We've started piloting acquisitions through tax sale, though very slowly. Though we're, you know, arguably about to be able to scale that up. We finally had memorandums of understanding put in place with all of the different entities, like governmental entities, that would have to approve using the tax sale power that we were given by the state. And so that took a long time, and they were just put in place. The city uses a couple outside foreclosure firms, and we're just completing MOUs with them. And so with those MOUs, we should be free to use that tool. We are approved and budgeted to acquire 320 properties in the current fiscal year that closes in June. We have approved 65 properties over the life of the land bank. So we are slow. We're not going to get to 320 this year. We remain falling short. I think as Nora will go into more detail, our various targets. 320, even if we hit it, is incredibly low. It's not going to have a large impact on the problem. And so the question is, can we scale up? There's a pretty complex and nuanced sort of budgetary question. The city chose to actually budget the land bank with money to pay off that tax debt after it acquires a property in sale. So it's sort of like the government giving money to itself. But the reason was so that the land bank would be able to pay the school district its portion of the property tax bill, so the school district wouldn't be waiving any of those dollars. Even though ultimately the school district and the city will benefit when properties get back on the tax rolls and are paying taxes. And so we have to, our budget is limited by how many dollars the city will hand us to try to pay itself back with taxes. Right now there's no public process to request or track acquisitions. It's kind of an inside game. So the public can't say, there's a vacant lot next to me, I want to garden it or use it as a side yard, can you acquire it for me? The delinquency and vacancy data we use for the strategic plan is not publicly available. Our original vision was that would be part of the website, and you could search for vacant properties, and you could see, is this one that the land bank might be able to acquire because it's got tax delinquency and it's vacant, and you would apply that way. That is not currently the case. So it makes planning hard if you want to do an assembly. Right now our website is just the stuff we already own. And some properties are still burdened with aged liens that the city sold in the 90s. The lien sale that has been proposed by Councilman Dom is differently structured than the one that was done in the 90s, but is still a really major red flag for the land bank and could impact the land bank's ability to operate. So that's a major current concern. So improving the processes, this is a part that is ongoing. There has been some staffing and agency reorganization. Labor negotiations have taken a while. There's still some in process. The land bank is not yet fully staffed, though it has started to increase its staffing capacity, but I think capacity is a major issue. Our website has more powerful search tools now. So you can search in, you know, defined areas, defined types of properties, you can look at zoning. So that's helpful, but it still has a ways to go. The fact that all the property has not yet been put into the land bank means that we still navigate multiple legal disposition processes across different agencies, even though some of that has been streamlined. These various approvals that are required, including through council and the various boards of the agencies, are creating log jams, particularly with high demand properties. And what that means is now that you can apply online, for properties where there is particular demand, you have multiple applicants. In many of those cases, there needs to be a competitive process. Council needs to sign off on that process happening. Council may not always, it may not think that that's appropriate, it may want to wait for a particular use, whatever the reason, or there may be no disclosed reason, and those applications aren't being processed. You need to balance the accessibility of being able to apply online, search properties, make it easier for people so we can get properties out, with the desire to filter those applications so we're not getting people who don't have any capacity to use the property and clogging up the system with these thousands of applications that we don't have the ability to screen and process. So that's a balance that we haven't fully struck yet. And what I hope to see looking forward, more open data, matching that vacancy and tax delinquency information with our public inventory. I think we have an incredible civic hacking community that could really unlock a lot of this. While the government has lagged, people have come up with really interesting tools to try to fit the need, and I think we could do more to partner. I think we need better public engagement, and some of these are themes that I know Nora will develop. We have had leadership transitions. We haven't had, we only recently got a permanent ED for the first time in the land bank, and so we haven't been fully operational as a public-facing entity that's a resource for telling people what can I do about vacant land in my neighborhood. We really need to focus on applicant experience and reform the process. The process to apply for and acquire public land is still pretty terrible, so we have far to go. We need to listen to people. We need to identify transparent performance benchmarks, that information that was mandated in the law to look at how long does it take to move through different steps in the process, where are things getting jammed up, and we need to make that available to the public so people can process to stay accountable. We need a strategic plan that looks at our past strengths and has some fresh vision. And I think we need to scale up pretty radically. The few hundred dispositions every year, acquisitions, are not going to get us anywhere near the scale of the problem that Ira identified. So, there you go.
While Mark, you bring that up, I've got a really low-tech thing I just scribbled down, okay? And what it is evening, everybody. I'm Michael Brady, I'm the Baltimore City's Housing Commissioner. So all the vacant buildings in Baltimore are my fault. That's the way it works. We're gonna talk a little bit about that. But I should have done this ahead of time. I was thinking, if you could just plug this into your phone or your laptop right here, one of these is a URL. Where you can get literally it's a parcel level map of every vacant city in Baltimore, even though Ira says I don't know where they are.
I said you were better.
Yeah. We'll talk a little bit about how I know where they are. But it's every vacant, it's whether the city owns them or our housing authority, where our homeowners are, et cetera. And then there's a website there, vacancytovalue.org. You might just want to take a picture of it or plug it into your computer or phone and pass it around. I can only write two. I'll be smarter next time. But literally, while you're sitting there, you can literally visit every vacant building in the city of Baltimore. You can also look at our website that tells a lot about our interventions and properties that we have available for sale at vacancytovalue.org. So before I start, this is Ira's latest production on the left, which is the housing market typology. Just rolled off the map last week, rolled off the production line. And that's a measure of our market housing market strengths and weaknesses. And on the right are where all the vacant buildings in Baltimore concentrate. So you can look at the two maps together and you can see the concentration of vacants is pretty much a proxy for the strength of the housing market. But let's just step back a little before we talk about vacants and think, you know, we can talk about overall percentages, but you can see it's not evenly distributed in the city of Baltimore, right? So what the overall percent of vacancy in Baltimore is doesn't really matter, because in your neighborhood it could be 50% and in another neighborhood it could be zero, right? So, and that's pretty much what you're looking at in Baltimore City. So what is it? I didn't come with a lot of pictures of what vacant buildings look like in Baltimore. If I was here with, sorry, he's the congressman now. He used to run Center for Community Progress. Dan,
okay,
did.
Okay.
They would have great pictures of, you know, the blight in Detroit. Baltimore looks very much like Philadelphia. So just picture your vacant and abandoned row house stock in Philadelphia. that's Baltimore as well. But what does that actually mean to live on that block, right? Well, just think about it for a second. It means maybe the house next door to you doesn't even have a roof. So in a row house environment, what does that mean in terms of you're trying to keep mold and water infiltration from coming in on that side wall? It's you're really not going to be able to beat that unless you roof the house next door to you. Maybe $35,000. Your house might be worth $35,000, right? So what else might you think of, right? You can almost, most places won't give you property insurance. If you're next to a vacant and abandoned building, you may not be able to get property insurance, and especially on a block of concentrated vacant buildings. That's pretty significant. You're looking at living in a market which is the opposite of what I was talking about with the displacement index. The value, the people who lived in that neighborhood years ago could afford 10 houses on the block now because the values are going down. But more than that, you can't leave. So you're on a block of like 20 houses. You're one of the last two people or three or five living there. You can't sell your house for what you would pay for rent for a year or two. You're actually stuck on that block. And what happens if one of the houses collapses and kills somebody? Add that to the list of sort of ignominies, humiliations, and sort of living in an area like that. So why would I want a job where I'm responsible for all that in City Baltimore? I haven't figured it out yet. But the question is, what can we do, you know, that's impactful in some way about these larger problems? So I'm going to talk a little bit about what we do in Baltimore about these issues. And for one thing, I mean, we did in fact have a building in April of 2016 that collapsed and killed an individual in Baltimore in a windstorm. And we literally had to dial that back and say, you know, what is it that we can do better to ensure that something like this never happens? Because that's part and parcel of these, you know, things you should never have to deal with. How can the city make it better than that? Incrementally better than that, we should be able to do that, right? So we did a series of engineering analysis, and we basically established you have vacant row houses in Philadelphia. When you get to the end of the row, right, what's structurally holding up that side wall is it's tied in with the floor joists and the roof. The thing works when you got a roof on it and all your interior joists. No roof, no interior joists, you got a free running wall, right? It's just imagine trying to get a permit. I'd like to put a brick wall out that's like two courses of brick wide, and it's 30 feet high, 35 feet high, and I want to run it 60 feet. And that's, you know, so can I, how about that? You know, that doesn't work, right? It blows over in the wind, right? It won't stand a wind load. So we did an analysis basically of every single end of group vacant building in the city of Baltimore. And every one of those, we looked at aerial photography of every single one of those buildings, established everyone without a roof, went out and inspected literally every one of those properties with either weak roof or no roof, and we ended up without using the sort of using consistent with constitutional due process, we declared these to be emergencies and requiring no notice and opportunity to be heard, because any building, we had engineering studies that essentially said any building in that shape won't handle wind loads, and depending on how many stories high or how long, what the wind loads were, and essentially what the regular wind loads are in Baltimore. So you can't say when any day in Baltimore you're going to have a 48 mile an hour wind, which is what killed that gentleman. So anything that can't stand 48 miles an hour in wind load needs to come down now, because it could be tomorrow. And we ended up taking about 400 buildings down and spent about $8 million in order to do that. Just to step back and say, to add to all the problems, we don't think we'll lose a child or another individual, and we can't foresee that. We had 60 mile an hour wind loads. We had 60 mile an hour gusts in the windstorm in Baltimore last week, and we lost two buildings that were foreseeable. The long story about why we sold buildings to somebody in that condition and then begged them to fix it. Those two fell, and then we had about two others that were not foreseeable. But that's very different than what might have happened in Baltimore otherwise. So I just wanted to get a taste of, these are dots on a map, these are colors of a neighborhood, but to actually live there and to arguably be a prisoner because you really can't sell is a difficult situation. So one of the things that, well, I'm just going to talk a little bit for a second about some of our interventions. So what do we do about it, right? Well, if you looked at the work that I already did, you can see Baltimore's a mosaic of different markets, of different market strengths. So there are some markets, right, which are middle markets. These are places in Baltimore that are freestanding homes. You may have these neighborhoods here too, that are freestanding homes where people back when they were built went to raise a family and send their kids to the local public school, and they had jobs in our industrial sector in Baltimore City. We were an industrial city. We went from about 950,000, as you heard, to about 620,000. I'm going to back up for a second. So we're down to 620,000. These are all the vacant and abandoned ones. It is my former colleague Julie liked to say to me that we lost 350,000 people, and they didn't take their houses with them, right? So, you know, the reality, you know. So what these dots are, I just want to say things and what these represent. These are 16,000, roughly, board ups in the city of Baltimore. How do I know where every one of those board ups are? It's not the ACS, it's not the census, right? This is our housing inspection operations, which I think is one of the arguably best in the country. Nothing to do with the fact that I used to run it. but we literally have our housing inspectors go out and they know where they concentrate, so they aggressively look there and they respond promptly to 311s everywhere else, and they take a picture, issue a violation notice, document it, and then we're going to talk a little bit about what we do about that information. Now that's a subset of all the vacants that Ira talked about. So there's vacant buildings, nobody's in it, and then there's a vacant that rises to the over which we have police power. What do we have police power over? We have police power over the vacant buildings that are either unsafe or unfit for human habitation and are a violation of our local codes, and as the building official, then I have authority over them. I can demolish them. I can bring them into our housing court if I want some action. I can move to appoint a receiver to sell the house, or what we like to call firing the owner. And so there's a lot of different tools that, you know, certainly I can just bring pressure. I can issue a citation. There are a number of different things I can do that can move those properties if there's a market. Right? And so in these middle markets, where the bulk of our residents have a lot of their wealth tied up, so Ira just did an analysis of these middle markets in a book that he wrote. I'll peddle Ira's book for him. It's called On the Edge, right? And it's about, Ira wrote a chapter in it, it's about middle market neighborhoods around the country. And Ira did a chapter on Baltimore. And telling us that half of our city lives in these middle markets. And the wealth of these citizens are tied up in an area where we have that small number of vacants, right? Small number of vacant vacants that are, we have violation notices for, but a larger number that are unoccupied. And for that, I don't have good data, so I will agree. And I'm after the Holy Grail, which is that parcel level data point for the unoccupied property. And I'm very close triangulating among our administrative data, our water data, our utility data, and the undeliverable address postal data. So it's the Holy Grail is to put that together. So in these middle markets, arguably, the properties have value. Maybe fewer people want to live here than used to, but the properties, very few vacants, maybe one on a block at most. So we should be able to use code enforcement. That should be all we need. Use code enforcement, push them back out into the stream of commerce, get somebody to renovate them and live in them. And so that's the strategy that we use. And we thought, well, with all due respect to our members of the judiciary, we said, let's get out of the courts. We have executive authority. Let's use our executive authority to issue $900 citations. That's going to be quicker and more predictable than litigating, cheaper, and of course it has a raising revenue component, but that's not what we're after. And let's just fire these $900 citations out, and let's get the owners to move these properties into the hands of somebody to do something with them. So that seems to make a lot of sense, and we're going to talk a little bit about whether, you might argue, was that successful or not, right? So I'll hold you in suspense about that. And then if somebody is not responsive to the citations, and that may be We talked, Jennifer talked a little about, you know, people do die, and in markets where, you know, where the market isn't behaving as you would expect it to, it's not going to get probated. And so therefore, it may sit idle. It may require other interventions in these markets. But it also may have a recalcitrant individual. These could be family properties that somebody just says, I can't let go of this house. I'm going to renovate it someday. Or, you know, and so we, at that point, we'll switch in these markets to receivership, which is a legal tool that we use in Baltimore. Because what we're saying is code enforcement should fix this, right? This isn't totally distressed. Code enforcement should be able to do it, right? And so we then move to a receivership model where we ask the court to appoint a receiver to pre-qualify bidders and auction the property for the highest price to within a set of pre-qualified bidders. These are people who have the ability to timely renovate a vacant house. Which renovating a vacant house, you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy. It takes a lot of work, time, and effort to get it right, right? So you don't want to sell the house. It's not any old auction where the highest bidder wins, right? It's got to be somebody who knows how to renovate a vacant building and do so timely. And if you buy one of these houses and you don't, you're off the list, right? So let's just give you a sense of order of magnitude. We're at scale. These are interventions that are automated and programmed into our business systems. We have automated business systems. These geographic areas are geocoded into the housing inspectors, automated workflow systems. And when you issue a violation notice as an inspector, you have a limited time to do the investigation to assure you know who owns it. We have a whole team of investigators. We can find anybody. And the beautiful thing about being able to find anybody is, if you can't find them, you better come up with plan B, because you know no one will if you can't. So, you know, they could be dead, or they literally are outside your ability to impact them individually. So we get some finality there. But once that violation notice is issued, the inspector has a certain amount of time to track down the owner, use the investigators if you need them, make contact with that owner, and then after that, we have inspector discretion about whether in that contact said, look, I'm really going to get a permit, or I'm going to list it for sale. You have discretion, and our inspectors use that discretion really well. They're really an unbelievable organization. But at a certain point, you know, you could run the clock down. And when you run the clock, when the inspector says you run the clock down, and the inspector himself or herself really can't extend it beyond a certain amount of time without supervisor approval. It's like getting the key from the manager to ring in a void or something like that. So you can't extend the notice past a certain time without the supervisor. And then, once we run out of time, the system automatically issues the $900 citation. It sends a notice out that says, hey, it's like a show cause, that says, I'm issuing you this notice in 10 days, a $900 citation in 10 days, unless you can show cause why I shouldn't. And that system goes in, and then we issue a second, and then it automatically goes to the lawyers. So it's, you know, no, it literally just happens. I don't have to think about it. When people in these neighborhoods call me about a vacant building next to them, I can rest assured as a building official, I really only have to think about it. If it's boarded up, it's going to go this way. If it's not yet boarded up, you call me. My inspectors will be out within 3 days and determine whether it should be. So middle market, I'll hold you in citation about how it works. Holding a suspense. So in distressed areas, these are, again, housing market typology. IRA actually only uses A, B, C, or D, right? But we gave it a valence.
Flavor.
Yeah, flavor, yeah. So in our distressed markets, and in distressed markets, vacants are concentrating, you're up at 35%, you know, vacant. And in these markets, they're very challenging, right? So at a minimum, from the building official's point of view, you want to be sure you are proactively inspecting and cleaning and securing every vacant building there, right? Because in some of our areas here, folks who live there have to call shots fired to get a police response. So they're not jumping to call 311 about boarded up buildings. So we need to do our job proactively. And so we will inspect these areas. And so some of them, those middle block vacants that you saw in some of the images with the weed trees growing into it, we generally stay ahead of that in Baltimore. So to minimize, again, what is it like to live here? It means if those vacant areas are filled with trash, you're going to get more rats. Drug dealers like trash. It's really good to hide a stash in. High grass and weeds, really good to hide a stash in. You want to do everything you can to keep the sanitation and the buildings down and the buildings secure. So we have a proactive approach here, and we probably clean and board 60,000 times a year, just to give you an order of magnitude. And most of that, 90% of it's proactive. The inspector's going out, affirmatively inspecting. But so it's not that we ignore these areas, and we're going to talk a little bit about some of the other interventions. We have a very aggressive inspectional intervention. But there are also areas that are proximate to strength. I was showing you that some vacants in Philly are in areas of strength. So you shouldn't expect to, you need a strategy, a whole block strategy if you've got a row house town, to move all your vacants in a whole block way out into the market if you're proximate to some strength and you have capitalized partners. They could be for or nonprofit. But you gotta do that in a whole block way. Investors, even our nonprofits, aren't interested in putting a new resident beside a roofless vacant. So you literally have to be able to move. How do you do that? How do you move an entire block? We own in Baltimore City probably 2,000 vacant buildings, 7,000 vacant lots. We don't really have a problem getting those out into the market. So we don't, do we need a land bank, not need a land bank? I don't want to answer that question because the mayor wants me to start a land bank. But I will tell you that one of the issues you want to solve with a land bank is move property into a market where there's demand, manage property that's vacant. Those are some things that we've been doing pretty well in Baltimore. That doesn't solve the problem because there isn't market demand and there isn't enough capital to renovate everything or demolish everything else. So you'd wonder, where's the federal government to help a city like Baltimore on infrastructure changes, like we're short 350,000 people and we gotta do something about the property. It's gonna cost money. Demo will cost money, cleaning and boarding will cost money, stabilization will cost money if we wanna use stabilization as a development subsidy. Anything costs money, and it's at scale. So when you showed the slides, when I showed the slides on Detroit, our good friends and colleagues in Detroit are awash in reprogrammed TARP money. Certainly not enough to meet their needs, but they got a third $100 million tranche. I think they've got $300 million of reprogrammed TARP funds from Treasury to deal with this demolition. Right? I ask, does anyone know how much Baltimore got? Zero. And arguably our problem in a dollar level is similar because we're a row house town. So if you want to do demolition in Baltimore on that block, which is where that last resident is, what that last resident is looking for is, hey, can I move to another block? No, I can't because I can't afford to sell my house. Well, how about if I buy your house at its value and I buy you another house? You get to pick where you want to go. Most people stay in the neighborhood. Then so all of a sudden you end up with Baltimore, housing prices are low, but you'll end up with $150,000 in equity. So even if you're a little bit elderly and say, you know, I'm actually fine where I am, your children will ensure that you move. And not just because they like you, right? So basically it ends up in a situation, and we, at that vacancyvalue.org site, we have, it's turning out, it's not what you read about in books about, like, oh, you know, relocation's always horrible. It isn't always horrible when folks have an option. Generally we don't move folks who don't want to move, but it's really rare, really rare. And to get, in some cases, and this is blight elimination demo, not major redevelopment. That's perceived very differently by folks. So these are areas of Baltimore where we basically say, if we have a capitalized partner or we know there's enough capital for whole neighborhoods might be in demand that were 35% vacant, we will bring all these tools into play. We'll receive these properties. We're not messing around with citations. We're not messing around with the housing inspectors. We'll take every vacant, send them into court because we know they're capitalized buyers. We'll take our inventory, sell them to those developers that are capable of developing them. We will plant street trees. We will repave streets. We will demolish the alley streets behind the productive blocks that are being reinvested. We will do what it takes to get whole block and trans transformational change in these areas. And so here I'm happy to tell you that the number of vacants have netted down by like 45%, which should give you a hint of what happened in the middle markets. So this battle, we're winning where there's capitalized partners and where we're capable of doing whole block solutions. And it's not a small part of the area. Major redevelopment, everybody's familiar with. You know, this is where a city's capitalized, you know, to actually, and the location matters in major redevelopment, but to go into a distressed area and be able to literally to acquire, relocate, demolish, assemble land, and redevelop. And this is a significantly, it's a costly intervention, you know, and in the world of municipal finance, there's TIFs that are involved in Section 1, and 108 loans from CDBG, and capital has to be assembled at scale, and you have to make sure that you're going way out of your way to ensure that people are comfortable who are living there, and that they will end up better than they were. This is, EBDI is a famous one. What I wanted to just show you is this little area here in the middle is where East Baltimore Development, Inc., which is one of these major redevelopments. This is the footprint of EBDI. This is the footprint of one of those community development clusters. And the data is just telling you where the vacant buildings have trended. Green's good, darker red's bad, right? So major redevelopment, irrespective of the footprint itself, is resulting in a halo effect of market interest and renovations in the neighborhoods around it. So in this case, this major redevelopment is reviving what were extremely blighted markets and outside of the major redevelopment footprint. And so this is the demolition piece. This is mapping the demolition efforts that we make. You see it maps with the concentration of vacants. And the question is, you know, even in some of our really impacted neighborhoods, you will find a gem of a block. There will be, you know, the original owner still on a block, or, you know, some intervention from the 80s or early 90s where new construction was built, new construction affordable housing in a sort of a townhome style. And this demolition that we do is going to target opportunities to support our existing residents. So you got a block of homeowners in a distressed area, and the studies that our friends in Cleveland and Detroit did after they got all their reprogrammed TARP money was essentially, I don't know if Ira agrees with their log with the actual math in their studies, but it shows you increase the equity in certain cases. How you target it, your demolitions will increase the equity in the homes of the people beside it, right? So we know where the homeowners are. We can strategically target demo to support them in distressed areas. We can also strategically target demo in some of these community development clusters to leverage investment, right? So on a principal street, you know, we're looking at potential redevelopment, but you've got an alley street behind where you can look down into the basement of the property, and you know, there's a lot of drug activity on the streets. And that's going to be an opportune place for folks to use and to sell. That's your view, not something that buyers of choice are going to elect. So we can strategically demolish alley blocks to support investment on principal ones. And then we do it to create permanent interim green space, which is important. So how does this come together? This is Greenmount West. And on the right here is Greenmount Cemetery. Where the vacant building stuff is, which is, in this case, an asset. And TRF, through their at one time development arm, full disclosure, you know, was one of the key nonprofit developers in this effort. So we had a combination of four nonprofit developers. This was a market severely impacted, probably easily 35% vacant. In this case, the red represents the vacant 2008. Here are our city dispositions. So this is our land. We're not a land bank, but we own a lot of land, right? And so here's what we did. So we're selling the concentration of dots on the upper right side there, in the middle of the over thing. You know, we're selling for an affordable housing, a LIHTC deal, affordable housing deal that we're gonna do. Because as this market's changing, we want to bake in as much affordable housing as we can, because we own a lot of land now, and we know where the trend is going, right? So this isn't even really cover the full number of city dispositions, but these are city dispositions the best I could map before I ran over here, right? These are these receiverships. So we're like this, these are things we do to scale, and we can do sort of comprehensively, right? And strategically, right? So now we're gonna file on what we don't own in a market that we know can be transformative, can be transformed, and our interventions can be transformative, and we're gonna bake affordable housing in. We're gonna move every vacant property out into the market, even for a nonprofit partner. So now you can take a look at how this starts to look. You know, is there some small amount of demo this was a market that was gonna absorb the vacant buildings for the most part. There's some amount of demo. These are the renovations, either rehabbed or under permit right now. So similar intervention in the market immediately north, where you see some of the same turquoise color. To combine, they're down 68% in BBN. So this is a significant positive turn in events. And what's left is 40% of what left is vacant is under permit right now. So it's like, if you can't, I would say to you, if you want to buy a vacant building in Baltimore, buy it here, but you're too late. So here's the affordable housing that we built in, about 700 units, either preserved or new construction, and the bulk of it's new construction. We did it at the time we could afford it. Okay, I'm down to 5 minutes. I think I'm at the end. So how did we do? On the right is the trend of vacant buildings in the city, the trend for the balance of the city, right? Not these streamlined code enforcement areas, which are middle markets, and not these CDCs. The rest of the city ticked up a little bit. So we were at 16,500, and we are at about 16,500 now, roughly 10 years later. Didn't change. We're rehabbing. Baltimore, there's gonna be about 1,500 rehabs a year. There's gonna be about 400 demolitions a year, and yet we haven't changed the net number of vacant buildings in Baltimore City. On the left, you can see in the CDCs, whoa, plummeted, nosebleed, dive down. The interventions are working because there's a market to we're leveraging market activity, essentially. And then on the left, the middle markets, the ones where it's almost all inhabited, and it's all mostly homeowners. And there's very few vacants on a block, and we have this code enforcement tool where we can immediately target the vacants and get them into the market. We look at the trend, we're going up, we're losing about almost every vacant building that was there at the start is no longer vacant. But like arcade ducks, they're popping back up with regularity. We're continuing to see population loss. The same trends that led to the loss of population in Baltimore and is now continuing in these markets. And in other areas, we're attracting population, right? So we're not netting down, and you can see this code enforcement intervention isn't enough. There are other things that we do. We have a healthy neighborhoods intervention, a whole other chapter in Ira's book. Actually, Paul Brophy is the editor who put together all the chapters. But healthy neighborhoods is an intervention in these middle markets to really market that neighborhood. We lend at 110% of value in healthy neighborhoods. We make mortgage money available. We do lots of marketing. You want to really celebrate your neighborhood. You want to make sure you green key corners. There are a bunch of things you could do if we're still losing the ballot. A bunch of other things. I just put a slide in. I'll definitely make my 2 minutes here. But just to show you, like, so what else do we do, even in these middle markets? You know, we do deferred loans. So does Healthy Neighborhoods, so do we. We do deferred, and by the way, we pay for the Healthy Neighborhoods work. The city does pay for it, actually. But the point is, you know, you're in your house, you're housed, you're a senior. You not being housed would be bad for you and bad for the city, but you can't afford to maintain your furnace, you can't afford to fix your roof, you can't afford to weatherize, which would save you money, you can't afford to put the slip and fall protections in that you need to stay there. We have programs and activities that do that strategically in the city. In the market that's coming back, we want to do that for you so you can stay there, right? And Baltimore has all sorts of circuit breakers so that your property taxes isn't going to be what puts you out, but it may be that you can't afford to fix the roof, And so we have programs to do that. We weatherize, we do deferred loans, and then we use our CDBG funds to promote low and moderate income home ownership. We got a bunch of different programs in play. And then we have a tremendous number of programs to manage the vacant land, community managed open space, we adopt a lot programs, side yard programs to buy the vacant lot next to you. We've got urban agriculture, we've got a tremendous number of use of a lot of our vacant land, and this is the flower factory, and this is one of our memorial garden. This is a adopt a lot that's used as a memorial garden in this case, an unfortunate incident that, but that the community has now adopted the lot as a result of it, and we have literally 1,000 of these around the city. So we try to make best use of our vacant land, our vacant buildings. I wish I could tell you we're winning the battle, but we're in the game. That's all I got.
So we've been sitting for a little while, and the first thing I want to do is just get a better sense of who's in the room. So you could either stand up or raise your hand if I read a statement that is true about you. So could you raise your hand or stand up if you're from Philly? Yeah, just keep up for a minute because I want to see everyone. Cool. Raise your hand if you feel like you're going to be in Philly for the next 5 years. Okay, some of us are going to do that. If you're a student in something related to planning or development, raise your hand. Great, good students. If you work in something related to planning or development, raise your hand. Okay, good. If you know someone who's been affected by gentrification or displaced, raise your hand. And if you think Philly has a chance to be a more equitable city, raise your hand. Oh, good, I want everyone to raise their hand. Great. You don't have to stand up for that. Okay, I'm going to go through a lot of slides. I'm going to go through it pretty quickly. I think it'll take about 12 minutes. But I work for a group called the Women's Community Revitalization Project, WCRP. And we were part of a coalition that helped to encourage and work with Jennifer and her ex-boss and a bunch of other people to create the land bank. And so I'm just going to talk a little bit about it from the perspective. I'm just going to get a little closer so I can see everyone. From the perspective, can people hear me? Is it okay?
We're recording it, so it would be good to...
Oh, okay.
It'll pick up.
Great. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it from the perspective of folks who are on the ground, talk a little bit, just a very little bit about accountability, but you can imagine we need to hold the land bank accountable, right? We've got to hold them accountable to get that land out there, and talk about our next effort, which is about taking vacant land and getting more resources through legislation and encouraging developers to pay a fair share so we can develop that land. So if I want this to go forward, I press it down, right? Great. Okay, that's a piece of vacant land, and that's a very short volunteer. The weeds are taller than he is, WCRP. WCRP's been around, for about 30 years, a little more than 30 years. We have a two-part mission. The first part is we build buildings. We've built about 300 homes. Most of that's residential. We've done commercial too. We have 70 in the pipeline. The second part is that we build the leadership of all of us who are doing this work. And we usually do it through policy and pushing resource decisions. This is a map. And I just want to say, WCRP and the coalitions we're part of is pro-development. We need market rate development in our city to generate resources, to pay salud, to play for the things that we need. So we are. But we're also for policies that are going to enable folks, middle income, low income, working class folks, and businesses to stay in our neighborhoods. When we've invested in our neighborhoods for a long time, we want to stay there. And that's what we've been talking a little bit about here. This is the neighborhood where we've done most of our work. That orange square is in the shows where we are in Philly. So this is the core part of our neighborhood. When you live, work, worship, study in a neighborhood, you know it. You know what's going on there. And a lot of the issues that we work on is because people have raised those issues. And when we do this work and people raise the issue and tell their story, lots of times you need to know the data. You need to know who else is experiencing the issue. You can say, this is happening to me, but we need to be able to say, I'm not alone in this. And sometimes we need to be able to say, this is an issue in the neighborhood, and we have some ideas about solutions. We don't need to necessarily wait, but we can encourage other people to see the ideas that we have. So a lot of our work is done in that way. So in this neighborhood, everyone knew there was a lot of vacancy. But it wasn't until we got it together to map it ourselves and then pay someone to help us map it, we found out, oops. Yes. One in every four pieces of land was vacant or blighted. So the highest use or most prevalent use was residential. The second highest use was not a use at all, it was vacancy. Everything that's gray was, this was in 2008, 2009. Everything gray was a vacant building, everything black was, I'm sorry, gray was a parcel, black building. The way we talked about it in our neighborhood, when you add all that up, it's about up to 79 football fields. People were excited that we knew this, but we're really upset about this. What we thought about vacancy was this is lowering our property values. Our kids are playing on these vacant lots, and there's all kinds of stuff on there. It's a problem. But as we were mapping this, we started to see more and more for sale signs on some of these vacant buildings and vacant lots. And we're saying, wait a minute. If we could have some influence on this development, we could have some influence on our neighborhood. Other people want our neighborhood. And so an example of that is that on three boundaries of our neighborhood, the top is the Piazza, 2006 before it was built, 11 after it was built. West, that's south of us, west of us, Temple, east of us, Fishtown. There was pressure. Another example of that pressure, here's our neighborhood again in two different time frames. To the left, it's between 2001, 2002. Median sales prices, everything in navy blue sold for 40,000 or less. To the right, it's 6 years later. This is the recession, 2007, 2008. There's almost no navy blue. And close to Northern Liberties to the south and to the east in Fishtown, properties were selling for above $200,000. We're feeling this, vacancy and market pressure. And so as I said, we listen to folks. A listening project is just when, it's not scientific. It's not something you probably do at school too much, but a listening project is when folks from the neighborhood come together and develop a set of questions about things they want to have intentional interviews about. They want to ask their friends and relations, people who go to church, go to mosque, they want to ask these questions. So it's not scientific, but you can get really honest answers because people usually know each other. In this listening project, we interviewed more than 300 people. The questions had to do with neighborhood change, vacancy, and we were also asking people about this tool that we learned about in some neighborhoods that have vacancy and market pressure called a community land trust. So talk to more than 300 people. When you talk to people, you have to invite them back to hear the answers. So this was at the report back meeting. And people were really interested in what their friends, neighbors, co-congregants, whatever you call people, said. But they didn't really get this community land trust thing. You mean the community would own land and people would own the structures like families or businesses, and you can sell it, but if you sell it, you can leave it to your kids, but do I have to sell it to people? Not at market value, but what people can afford. So they asked for another meeting, and we had it, and we talked through all these issues, all the pros and cons. At the end of the meeting, people were asked to take their name tags off and put it on a continuum. Great idea, bad idea. You can see where they put their name tags, and that's when we created the Community Justice Land Trust. It's one of 250 land trusts. Oh, I love this slide, because then our name comes up. Yay. 250 land trusts, roughly, in the country. Okay, we have this land trust. It's a structure to own land, to keep housing and other uses affordable, but we did not have any land. We had a land trust. And around the same time, other folks in other communities, this was the organizations in our neighborhood in Eastern North Philly, but other organizations were talking about some of the same issues, vacancy, blight, and in some market pressures. So our coalition from Eastern North Philly got in touch with other neighborhoods, and we created a campaign and a coalition called the Campaign to Take Back Vacant Land. At that point, it was 44 organizations, but it got to be a little bit more, up to 60. And we were thinking, there was this new legislation at the state level to create land banks. Well, that could give us a resource, and that was possible. So we pushed to get the legislators to create a land bank in our city. But we didn't want a land bank that just gave out land for market rate uses. We wanted it to be affordable too. We brainstormed values. Our values are fairness, accountability, transparency, and we had goals related to those values that we wanted to see incorporated into land bank legislation. We were lucky that we had a pretty good champion. And so what do you do when you want an idea and you want these politicians to do something? You have to go out and stir things up a little bit, right? So we had community meetings in every neighborhood that we could where there was an organization involved. We went to City Hall, we testified, we had a land bank teach-in about the difference between a land bank and a community land trust. Dan Kildee, who was mentioned earlier, he was there. We did all this stuff. We were waging this campaign, as Jennifer said, for a while, right? So we had to come up with pretty interesting tactics. So on voting day, we wanted to highlight that a lot of the land was owned by people who weren't paying their taxes. So we hung out with different council people. We did that. Every weekend, we went out and cleaned up vacant lots. Folks came out because the lots, they hated those vacant lots. So they cleaned them up. We invited people to do it. And at the very end, when we were trying to get the legislation out of committee, we posted on land, people were pretty angry with us in the city, that this land was dangerous. And if you cared about this, you would call your council person, have to be Janie Blackwell at the time, and she could still use a little pushing, to vote that legislation out of committee. So when you get calls, sometimes you respond. And the good news is we won. And in fact, we were involved with folks to help draft the legislation, and we won language in the legislation that included all of our values. So I don't want to say much about this, but just we still have to hold the land bank accountable. I'm not really going to talk about it because you heard from Jennifer from a really good source exactly what they're working on and where they need to get better, but we know that it needs to get better. And so what we do is we hold a lot of trainings and teach-ins before. We want a land bank strategic plan hearing so that we can turn out and tell people what we want. But now I want to talk for a minute about what we're doing next. And a lot of the same groups that were part of the campaign to take back vacant land said, okay, if we're going to get land through the land bank, it's a big if, but if we're going to get land through the land bank, we need money to develop that land, right? You know, you can't just do it because you have land. You have to have resources. So we're trying to get, ideally, a series of laws that will expand and protect affordability by creating new resources and money that would go into our city's housing trust fund to produce housing, to repair housing. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of data from this campaign. Here it shows that one out of every two renters in the city is paying too much for their rent, too much mandated by what HUD would say was too much, which is 30% of your income on your rent and your utilities. One out of every two people who rents in Philly is paying too much. One out of every three homeowners is paying too much. HUD would say they're housing impoverished. And these numbers have only gone up. And this data is from 2012, and it's probably worse now. This is shows where the most transactions happened in the city, and we're just looking at how wages are staying stagnant for many, many folks. But the cost of housing is going up. So the neighborhood where I do most of my work, the houses went up 200% between 2000 and 2012. And in the same period, incomes went down by 6%. And lots of times you can't tell if a neighbor is gentrifying by what the incomes are, because there's still a lot of poor people in the neighborhood, but you can by the prices. And so one other data point that says we're being hurt, oops. One data point that shows that folks are getting pushed out. This is just about African-American households, and it's from the census, but it shows you in the neighborhood where I have worked, 22% fewer African-American households than there were in 2000. This was in 2012. And if you look at West or South Philly, a third of the African-American households are no longer there. This is about the issue. And so our solutions to this issue can be a lot of them, but the one we're working on right now is a housing impact fee. And some places call it linkage, but it's just about getting the developers. Like, they develop these things roughly for $250 or $300 a square foot. That's what it costs them to do these fancy houses. And we would like to add $2 a square foot onto that. And they would pay that as a housing impact fee, and that money would come in for affordability and to help folks who need it in neighborhoods that are being impacted by their development. We don't want to slow it down, and we've done a lot of research that shows that wouldn't slow it down. But we do want them to pay their fair share, and there are leveraging. So in addition to creating about $7 million in the housing trust fund, it would leverage other money. And this is what it could create every year if we got that amount of money in terms of new rental units and home repair and homelessness prevention. So that is the end. Except that I made a lot of hard copies of stuff. I don't know if people today like hard copies, but I made copies of land bank legislation with all the good juicy parts highlighted. I have information about the campaign to take back vacant land and development without displacement. But I also have flyers, because one thing is that many elected officials respond to phone calls. And on March 28th, we're having a call-in afternoon between 12 and 2 to kind of bombard the legislator's office with the idea that they need to support things like these impact fees. So if you want to do it in your own office, we'll send you a packet. If you want to come and have lunch at 8 in the Arch where we're going to do this, you're welcome. The end.
Well, I'd like to thank our panel, first of all.
Did you say, when you were showing kind of vacant houses going up and down over time, did you say that it was middle market where you had vacancies that were piling up?
Where the numbers weren't netting down. So, you know, we've built some efficient systems to address the vacancies that come up, but the market's continuing to lose population. So after all this aggressive sort of efforts in so many fronts, we're still netting down. And that, you know, that's speaking to the larger desirability of these markets to a new generation. But we need pressing on the problem, because that's where so much of Baltimore has its wealth tied up. So if we cannot, the failure to revive these markets means it's a massive loss in family wealth. That's the starkness of the issue.
And so is the city of Baltimore on the whole still losing population, or is it just the middle market neighborhoods?
So we finally stabilized the 620, but that gives you a sense of the churn, right? So it's there are people moving out, there are people moving in, and that's, again, talking about a city as a whole when it's really a mosaic of different neighborhoods behaving differently doesn't really characterize any individual neighborhood. So we stabilized the 620, but you know, not these middle markets are losing population. Again, it's a house, we already lost enough population to get down to one per household, you know, and now we're going vacant. And then the foreclosure crisis exacerbated all of that. So.
My son just moved from Baltimore. I'm sorry about that. Enjoy his 2 years there.
Yeah.
I was wondering, politically, what is it about the politics in Baltimore that permit you to have so much authority over what's going on? And makes it much more difficult in Philadelphia for Jennifer or the land bank to have so much authority.
You know,
or so lack of authority.
Yeah, I would say that the thing about every locality is different. Every political sort of landscape comes with its own set of landmines. I have problems that you don't, I'm sure. You have problems that I don't. But Philadelphia, from what I understand, you are all the expert, sort of known for having this sort of councilmanic, you know, I don't know what the word is, like Byzantine councilmanic run, like operations with so much power. We have a much stronger mayoral operation where the executive agencies have much more discretion to implement the mayor's plans.
So it's a stronger mayor, weaker council.
We certainly do not have a council that runs things in the way you do. We have a board of estimates that, you know, tries to exercise some authority over the disposition, acquisition of property. They do have that authority. We don't need a land bank because we can navigate that. But the mayor controls 3 of the 5 votes on the board of estimates.
Tell Catherine and say hello.
I will. Do you know her?
Very well. Yeah.
Tell her I did it. Could you tell her I mentioned her a few times?
I will.
I appreciate that.
I wonder if I could say something in terms of, like, it seems like aggressive inspection. I guess I'm going to ask, are we doing enough in terms of inspection? Or can we learn something from Baltimore?
With the secret IRA, but I think IRA is at times partnered with LNI to do some like strategic analysis, and we've taken some steps from being totally reactive and complaint driven to having a little more capacity. But the biggest distinction is actually, and I think Judge Moss can speak to this to some extent, you described a system where you use these larger front-end fines and then use receivership, whereas our system gives violations with no fine attached. Then we file a complaint with sometimes a modest fine. Don't always litigate those all the way to an equity process. And so a lot of that is in a court that doesn't have equity powers, and so you're just sort of churning these small fines. Don't file all the equity cases. Like, we have analysis around the number of unsafe properties that never have a court case filed, and we have no alternative that we are employing, like receivership, where you're just jumping to take over and redistribute. And so that system, I think it's because you've been in a position where they've had to give Judge Moss particular calendar days to handle it, and I think that this court process we have does not have the, like, staffing, time, capacity to process the kind of
I think everything you say is correct, Jennifer. think one of the Baltimore is more strategic than Philadelphia is, and so you know Philadelphia is a big city, so LNI is not working with the law department and with people who to say, hey, this is the neighborhood just like you were describing and we want to take a look at. We had a program in Philadelphia called the Windows and Doors Program, which was extremely successful. I was a judge that presided over it, but it was extremely successful. One of the reasons it was successful was not because of me, but because they were very strategic on what neighborhoods they were taking a look at. So it's a combination of what you say and a combination of what Baltimore is doing, and that is being strategic in what neighborhoods it's looking at.
And what jumped out to me was you described, I mean, you said it's something that is effectively automated and built into business processes. That sounds to me like essentially the opposite of the system we have, which is highly individualized. And so you would deal with individual property owners and try to like push them and nudge them. And so I'm very interested to hear that.
We started there. It was like the tyranny of the lowest level actor, you know, and now we've sort of raised it up to we built the capacity and have it management driven according to what we think is a sensible strategies. Unfortunately, we wish that it used to be, and it's often the mindset still is, you have all these vacant properties because code enforcement isn't doing their job. If you just punish the bad people who own the vacant houses, you wouldn't have any vacant houses. It's just one of the many silver bullet theories that are out there. You know, if you increase the taxes on vacant properties, that may work in some markets where there is a market and you want to disassociate the owner from the property, but where it has negative land value, you know, I always say, you know, first of all, we know where the tax delinquent properties are. A third of them are either tax exempt, tax delinquent, or tax delinquent. But if you find somebody on the block of vacants paying taxes, give him a medal, you know, raise the taxes.
I'd like to address the question of creating affordable housing. I know that Nora talked about the impact fee, and I know in other places they've attempted, and it's even been talked about here, to have inclusive zoning ordinances where a certain percentage of any above a certain size of building project has to include affordable housing. And recently there was information, and I think I have this right, where in Portland, Oregon, when they had inclusive zoning ordinance, that it drastically lowered the amount of development on the part of developers. And so is this, well, I guess my question's two-part. Is this in part a function of the fact that there are so many different markets that developers can choose, pick and choose, to run to sort of the, you know, kind of Gresham's law, where they go to the most profitable and easiest place to make money? Or, and if this was more universalized, that this wouldn't be the case? Or is it, you know, particularly that's not a very good instrument to create affordable housing? And what are people's views about what tools are effective to do this?
So inclusionary, I don't know how it worked in Portland, but Portland did just pass linkage, like an impact fee. But I think that you have to look at the effect on the market. So generally, it's considered by the courts a taking. If it costs so much for the developer to put an affordable unit in that they can't, it's capitalism, they live in, right? So I think there has to be some analysis. I don't know what happened in Portland, but in Philly, the costs to do development are high, and the market is not that high, right? What you can earn on it. And so if you're doing inclusionary housing, it's very hard to do what's called on-site inclusionary housing. And so generally, inclusionary housing can be right in the same building. But if you want to rent to most folks in Philadelphia, about 100% of the city median income is $37,000 or $38,000 for a family of four. So you can calculate what the rents could be or what that family could afford to buy. I might be giving you too much information. But in any event, there's off-site and then there's in lieu. And so when we're thinking about inclusionary housing in Philly, we have to think about what the market is, what can be born, and how can we serve the people who are really struggling and really are getting pushed out these neighborhoods or can't afford their rent. I don't know. Does that answer your question?
No.
almost, I hate to think like an economist because that's not what I am, but I think that you could think about this as a pricing problem, right? Portland is a reasonably robust real estate market. And so you would think that it could absorb some of this additional cost to be able to produce something that is some other public benefit, which is affordable housing, there or somewhere else, right? Somewhere within the city of Portland, obviously, that's the way it worked. But I think, and it hasn't been like really evaluated yet, so we don't know exactly what the problem was, but I think that most likely what the problem was is something around how large that fee was. So in other words, it sort of pushed it to the point where it was no longer, there wasn't enough price support for the units that they were constructing to be able to construct and generate a reasonable profit out of it at the same time. And so with that fee, essentially it caused this pricing problem, which sort of, you know, ground it to a little bit of a halt. Now, I think the other thing to consider is not every tool works in every circumstance. So Portland is a hot market. Philadelphia is a modest market. You could probably more easily get away with that kind of thing in a hot market, in really like a San Francisco, because you can sort of just keep pushing the prices higher and higher and higher. New York City, to a degree, Boston to a degree, Washington to a degree, but Pittsburgh, probably not. Baltimore, probably not. If people are willing to pay this much to be there, and as Michael showed you, in those middle market areas, which are pretty affordable, there's still, you know, even the price points that they're offering, you're still not like dragging people into those neighborhoods to refill them as people move out. You know, there will be, you know, it's probably not the kind of tool that you can attach to the sale of real estate in a place like a Baltimore or a Philly or a Pittsburgh to any great, you can, if you calibrate it small enough, you can probably get away with it. But if it's so small, you're just not generating that much.
But as I understand it, that these measures generally throw something in which makes the situation better for the developer. They usually allow greater density, greater height, something
that's
to
right.
allow the developer to recoup
mm-hmm.
what otherwise would be lost. So that, in that sense, you know, I don't understand your analysis because, you know, there isn't the takeaway, you know, that causes them, or there shouldn't be the takeaway.
If what they're getting back
yeah.
is fully compensating what they're giving up.
Right.
That really is the question. And whatever profit they're going to want to take out of it, right? I mean, so that's the other piece of it. It's like, on top of it, they have to be able to, I mean, they're going to want to be able to take some sort of profit out of it, particularly if they're a for-profit developer. So I still think it just becomes more or less a pricing issue. If it costs $1,000 to build this house, and you're going to say, I want you to give up a certain amount that we can put towards something else, and I'll let you build 1.2 houses on this particular spot, yeah, I'm going to make a little more money, but is it enough to compensate for that cost? And that really is the kind of analysis. Nor is a nonprofit developer, and she can't, you know, hemorrhage dollars when she does a development. So she has to sort of think about, you know, again, what is the price of constructing this, and is the price that I can demand for the good after sale is enough to compensate for that?
Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Oh, it's just a tiny point, just that there was some speculation in Portland that folks had gotten a bunch of permits before the law went into effect, and the slowdown was partly because so much stuff was already permitted in the pipeline, and so you can't totally judge this window, you know, as a marker for what
I
was saying.
I just wanted to jump in because I haven't said anything on the topic, but actually, I think this is relevant. There are different issues on affordability, so if you make $100,000 a year, you can't afford to live in San Francisco, right? They're three miles out. That's not Baltimore's affordability problem. That's probably not Philadelphia's problem. As Ira mentioned, you make $100,000 a year, you live anywhere in Baltimore, right? Literally, you know? But that's not Baltimore's affordability problem. Our problem is we have people who can't compete, who are too poor to compete in the marketplace for housing. And so then when you talk about the issue you raised is how do we sort of, you know, somehow produce, offset the costs of building affordable housing on that locality, and you could say, yeah, but where's the social safety net? what are we doing with our federal dollars? You know, couldn't we just, all Baltimore, we spend in Baltimore 200, well, just on Section 8 alone, we pass $150 million a year through the city from the federal government to do that. But if you can't afford housing, you either won that Section 8 lottery. But what would the cost of funding a Section 8 program for everyone who needed it? We're forcing on the locality some way to solve a problem, you know, mostly democratic, you know, cities, you know, solving this problem, which is really could be easily funded by the federal government 10 times over for what we just have done recently. So I'm just saying, all your points are valid, they're different in different cities, but we could also look at it 10,000 feet up and say, where's the money come from for the social safety net?
Your point is also a scale problem. Like, just because we're on the topic, I think that there's multiple policy goals for doing, and they're a little bit different, or as impact fee would fund off-site housing. The inclusionary zoning proposals have been described both to potentially solve a goal of fair housing, like income diversity within and racial diversity within a particular housing location, as well as potentially the alternative of people paying into, like, our trust fund to fund other off-site housing. But the scale, so like you could do inclusionary zoning because you believe in diverse communities and that's totally valid. The scale of any of that is not going to meaningfully chip away at our housing program, so you don't necessarily want to mix those things. Like, we are so far away from that overall policy goal. You do need to look at vouchers and things.
And I was going to say, if you have the ability to do some of these programs in a targeted way, maybe you get away with them. So for example, in a Northern Liberties or in a, you know, Point Breeze, you might be able to get away with that because the market is sufficiently strong that the price would support it. You try to do that with somebody who wants to build infill housing in East Oak Lane, and it just doesn't work. It, you know, there isn't the price for it. Or, you know, we can name 20 neighborhoods in Baltimore where it wouldn't. We can name maybe two that it would, right?
Well, we were supposed to end a while ago, so I think I'm going to have to wrap up. First of all, please join me in thanking our panel. Conveniently, we moved into the issue of impact fees and using zoning as one mechanism to promote affordable housing. Our next session of the public conversation is going to be on zoning, so please join us on April 10th. At the Amato Recital Hall to 5:30 for the next session. So thanks very much for coming, and thanks again, Jason.